So I went into the Great Wall, kind of hoping to find something new, something creative, something different, different from Hollywood standards, at least what we're getting right now. Wasn't trying to reboot a franchise, wasn't trying to tug at my nostalgia boner, wasn't to remake sequel adaptation, yada yada. I was hoping for something creative, something that takes imagination, something that would hopefully do well, and Hollywood would look at it and be like, oh, we can be creative and still sell, kind of thing. Unfortunately, that's not what we got. I know it's weird. I'm actually going with popular opinion this time around, but it's kind of true. It's a dull film. It is clever. I did technically get what I was looking for coming into it. I don't know if it's like an adaptation of an anime or a manga or, some sort of Chinese mythology they adapted into film. It's still different, okay? It's still something we hadn't quite seen yet. But unfortunately, even as far as story goes, it's subpar. Now, the good thing that I will say about this, the cinematography was pretty cool. And not so much, I say cinematography, but it was more design. The design of the film was really awesome. It actually kind of reminded me of Heroes. If anybody's ever seen that, it's on Netflix. Check it out. It's amazing. But the idea of, the story goes, there's people on the Great Wall. This is ancient times where there's still people on the Great Wall defending against something. What that something is, well, I'll get to that in a second. That's all plot explanation, and I don't want to get into that just yet. But ancient China, soldiers on the wall, and I thought personally, I can kind of see how people would find it stupid, but everything was colorful. And again, so new, so different, so creative. It took imagination to come up with that idea. You have the battalion people who are all purple and black, dress. The costume design was really awesome. The archer people were all in red. I can't remember what the yellow guys did, but they're yellow people, guys dressed in yellow regalia, military Chinese type fighting stuff. You had the blue unit, which were all women for whatever reason. They were bungee jumping down to stab at shit, and it was really cool looking. And I give it praise for that. Just that alone was really cool. In fact, you could take the first, I don't know, 30 minutes of this film, cut it off, leave it at that, and it's actually a pretty decent little skit, with all that creativity. Even the action sequences weren't that bad, though. And this also kind of goes into the plot. The whole mentality of what they're fighting is supposed to be a mystery. I don't get that. Especially since the whole, what are these things? What are we fighting? You get to see them again within 30 minutes of the film. And also, if you watch the trailers, you know what they are already. The trailer showed you what these monsters are. They're CG lizards. Basically it. You thought there was more to it? Not really. They tried. They really tried to be different, but it's no. It's actually, this movie is very Starship Troopers. If you've ever seen that, you get it. Without the hokiness. Actually, the hokiness is there, but it's actually trying to take itself seriously, which makes it bad. The whole concept of the monsters being a mystery, it's not a mystery for long, because then we have to get to the fight scenes. We have to make use of our big ass CG budget, but that being said, the first encounter with them is the stupidest thing I've ever seen in film, where our main heroes, Matt Damon and Pedro Pascal, or the guy from Game of Thrones who got his, oh, never mind, almost spoiled it. But those two, they're camping at night. They're with a bunch of other guys, and one of the monsters shows up and attacks a bunch of guys. And it tries to play out like a horror film where you don't see it. Again, I complained about this in Split as well, where you see Matt Damon looking over to the campfire, you know, you assume in your head that, oh, these guys just got attacked due to the sound effects and the camera, you know, the camera, like, goes behind one of the guys sitting by the campfire and, you know, the camera kind of, like, jumps him, he screams, there's these sound effects. Then it cuts to Matt Damon, like, looking over towards the campfire. And this really long shot, too, of him looking towards the campfire, you know, he's been away from it, but you could see the light from it, and he's looking over there, and he, like, slowly pulls out his sword. It's like, does he see it? Does he see nobody there? Because to our understanding in the audience, there were a bunch of guys at a campfire, and now here's Matt Damon sneaking towards the camp, and then a quick cut point of view shot of the campfire being empty. You know, it's like, well, how did he not see that? You know, how did this, you know, there's like two or three of them, these guys who just fucking disappear within a matter of like one quick sound effect in this camera shot. That alone was dumb. But then he and his friend, you know, they keep hearing noises. They have their weapons ready. You know, they're ready to fight whatever it is. And then you get a fight sequence where you're not supposed to see what the monster looks like, right? And so you're supposed to film a sequence where these two guys are fighting a monster, but even they don't know what exactly is they fought. Doesn't make sense, I know. But basically, the idea with that is make it really dark and use shaky cam so you don't know what the fuck is going on. Essentially, the Lord of the Rings fight scenes. and then the monster tumbles down a cliff, you don't see it again in shadow, and they're like, what the fuck did we just kill? So stupid. Again, if you want to make it a mystery, then don't show it in the trailer. Better yet, don't hide it for only, like, a quarter of your runtime, you know? Because, again, they get to the wall, and almost instantly, you see, clear as day, and in daytime, for that matter, these monsters. So what was the fucking point of them fighting it at night? You know, like, there was no consistency. They didn't know if they wanted it to be, like, this mystery to get you to go see the film to see what the heck these monsters are, or, you know, if they just... I don't know. But other than that, the choreography was really cool. The fight sequences were really cool. Very Helm's Deep. I just made a jab at fight scenes in Lord of the Rings, but I still appreciate the whole idea of, you know, this long shot of siege, and you see all the different pawns, you know, play their part in this battle kind of thing. That's always fun for me. And they do that. And you can easily tell what's going on too, thankfully, because the costume designer decided to actually put color into a film. Fuck yeah. Thank you. It's so good. The costume design and, like, the whole look of the army, it's so cool. But then the movie just kind of stops there. There's not much else to say about it. It pulls the whole Last Samurai, Dances with Wolves thing, where it's, you know, Matt Damon as this white guy, surrounded by Japanese people, being, like, the best out of all of them, like, despite the fact that all these soldiers on the Great Wall have been training all their life, Matt Damon's, like, the best at killing shit, somehow, you know, white man shows up, saves the day kind of thing. They obviously tried to gloss it over by putting Pedro in, because, oh, a Spaniard is also saving the day too, but he's also kind of portrayed as a dick. So, it doesn't quite work that way. And, yeah, Matt Damon's basically there so people could watch it. They didn't have to have his character there for this plot to really work the way it did, but, you know, if there wasn't a white guy involved, not a lot of people would see it. I unfortunately understand that. I don't agree with it, but I understand that concept. And that's kind of where this whole, you know, going in to see a movie that's creative and different really died down for me, because technically it was, you know, it wasn't, story-wise, it wasn't something we'd seen yet. I mean, barring the obvious, you know, stuff it's been taking from, like Independence Day, Starship Troopers, Last Samurai, etc. you know, despite that, it is different, it is clever, and all this stuff, but at the same time, the tropes were there. You know, again, the whole Last Samurai thing, I was okay with, but then you have the strong female protagonists kind of thing, which I appreciate, I love it, but it's so pandering, it's sickening. Like, it's so obvious that I'm not optimistic enough to assume that, you know, this is Hollywood learning its lesson and being like, yeah, okay, yeah, more female leads, this is awesome. It's more, oh, to get women's rights activists off our backs, let's make sure we have women in our movies who are strong and independent. You know, again, it's a nice step, but the reasons for it aren't the right reasons. You know what I'm saying? It's if this thing ever falls, you know, falls flat, or not falls flat, but if this thing ever ends, you know, this whole women's rights, you know, treatment of women, especially in popular media, if this ever dies down and, you know, we got a taste of all the women we needed, that sounded terrible, if we got enough of women in popular culture to kind of quell this whole thing that we're at right now, Hollywood's just gonna go back to the way it was, you know? I don't see it as a sincere attempt. Which sucks, because then you see it, watch a movie like this, and once again, here we have a strong female lead. It's one way awesome, and another way just so headache-inducing, because it's like, yeah, I know why that's there, I know why she is how she is. You know, it's just now this new drop in the formula of how the perfect Hollywood movie works. Man, I cannot talk today. So yeah, it's a trope now. You know, they took something that was supposed to be made aggressive and turned it into, you know, a trope where you can go see any movie now and expect to see this. Again, it's a good thing, but for the wrong reasons, I feel. So again, yeah, it's a money grab. And again, it sucks because I went into it hoping for creative, imaginative, breaking the norm, telling Hollywood, hey, we can do something that isn't within your perfect Hollywood idea of what a good movie is, or how a good movie is written, or, you know, what it needs to be in order to be successful, and, you know, take that, run away with it, and teach Hollywood a lesson about, oh, maybe we do need to make more creative movies, maybe we do need to break from the norm, or what is our norm. But no, it's just as much a Hollywood film as any other. Honestly, I don't know why I was so... I mean, watching the trailers, I wasn't even that interested in seeing it. I couldn't even tell you why. Just nothing about it grabbed me. Just the whole concept of it didn't quite catch my interest. But at the same time, I was like, well, I should probably give credit where credit's due, because again, it's not trying to do what every other movie is trying to do right now. But I didn't read between the lines, and it turns out it was. And that's the long and short of my story. Hope you enjoyed my review. 2 out of 5 things exploding.